Hello. In this video, we are going to talk about scoring for brass instruments and also about their combinations with other sections of the orchestra. The four major functions of the brass choir are as a homophonic unit, alone or in combination with other orchestral choirs, as a presenter of the melody. This one is not as common as the first one, but we still have many examples in which a brass instrument plays the melody alone or in combination with other instruments, as a builder of orchestral climaxes. As you know, the string instruments are the core of the orchestra. Then we add woodwinds as color instruments, and the major characteristic of the brass instruments is their volume. That makes them a great choice for orchestral climaxes. And finally, as a provider of coloristic effects, such as muted, jazzy, or more novel sounds and techniques. Because brass instruments are extremely powerful, composers and orchestrators must be very careful not to overuse them, because they can easily overshadow the rest of the orchestra. Before we start talking about some characteristic examples, I'd like to give some examples of early uses of the brass choir. This is an example of the use of the brass instruments in the late Renaissance music. The example is taken from a work by Giovanni Gabrieli. Actually, we are not sure about how many instruments and which instruments exactly were playing this passage, but we assume that we have three trumpets and three trombones were playing it. And probably there were also other doublings about which we are not sure. Let's listen to it. There is not much to say about this excerpt actually. The only thing I'd like to mention is the voicing of the brass instruments, an open structure in the trombones and a closed structure in the trumpets, following the principle of the harmonics, larger intervals in the low register and smaller intervals in the higher registers. We still apply this principle in writing for brass instruments. And this is an example from Baroque period taken from Royal Fireworks music by Handel. Before we start listening to it, a notice about the score. We have only three horns and three trumpets here without trombones. And as you see, the score is in C for educational purposes, but actually both groups are in D in the original score, and the horn section sounds one octave lower than written. Let's listen to it. As we already talked about, in the Baroque era, we don't have the concept of the orchestration yet. We have three melodic lines. We have a primary melodic line, then we have a secondary melodic line, and a bass line. We find the primary melodic line and the secondary melodic line also in the other instruments. This is the primary. And then the secondary melodic line is also here. Second oboe as well. And the bass line is also present, sometimes partly because of the registral differences. For example, until that point, it is exactly the same. This is the third trumpet part. But after that, they become different for two pitches. And here we have also one common pitch. This part is also different. And at the end, they are once again the same. Almost the same. We can say that this part, trumpet part, also the horn part, is a variation of the bass line. And also the third oboe. And bassoons are playing the entire bass line at octaves. A very typical instrumentation for the Baroque era. And this is also a very typical usage of the brass section as antiphon. We call this usage antiphon. We hear a musical motif, a musical idea in the strings and in the woodwinds, and then it is repeated in the brass section alone. And once again, strings and woodwinds. And then all together. Another characteristic of the Baroque instrumentation is that the brass instruments are almost always supported by timpani. As you see, in the timpani, we have exactly the same rhythmic structure as the one in the brass section, with some small differences like this one. Another thing worth mentioning is the melodic deviations between the other sections and the brass instruments. As we said, the first horn and the first trumpet play the same line as the first violin and the first oboe, but with some differences, especially in the difficult passages. For example, this passage. This line is easy for string instruments and for woodwind instruments, but it would be difficult to play for brass instruments, especially in that era. So, in the horn, we have a simplification of the melodic line. It begins with C, and we have this B in common, and at the end they come once again together. And in the trumpet, it begins with A, exactly like the melody, but after that the first trumpet takes over the second melodic line. Because of the technical limitations of these instruments, such changes had to be made. And also notice that the first trumpet is the instrument that we hear the loudest throughout the excerpt. Let's listen to the excerpt once again. In the Baroque era, not every piece included brass instruments, of course, but if the composer used brass instruments in the piece, then he used them throughout the piece, as we saw in this excerpt. However, in the classical era, the composers became much more careful about the use of the brass instruments, except for the horns, of course, which were favorite instruments for the pedal tones, for the sustained tones. But the other brass instruments, which we call heavy brass instruments, such as trumpet and trombones, were mostly included at the musical climaxes. This is an excerpt taken from Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. At the brass section consists of two horns in C, two trumpets in C, alto trombone, tenor trombone, and bass trombone. Like in the previous example, in this example, the brass section is also supported by the timpani. Let's listen to it. Also notice the different durations of the chord tones in different instruments. For example, in the piccolo and flutes, we have staccato quarter notes, but in the other members of the family, we have half notes. The same is true for the strings. The reason is that Beethoven didn't want the highest pitches to be dominating here. He just wanted to highlight the beginning of the chords. After that, they stopped playing. We see a similar usage also here in the brass instruments. Dotted quarters against the half notes of the woodwinds and strings. Let's listen to it once again. Doubling or voicing is another very important topic in using brass instruments in the instrumentation. In woodwind instruments, we saw four different kinds of voicing, such as superimposed, interlocked, overlapped, and enclosed. We applied the same principle also to the brass instruments. Let's take a look at the first two of this voicing. We have a D major chord, and the voicing of the chord is almost the same with two differences. First of all, in the first voicing we have an A here, in the second one not. Instead of this, we have a doubling of the bass note between the third trombone and the tuba. Another difference, and this is more important than the first one, we have two horns here and we have four horns here. That means there is one horn playing F sharp and one horn playing D. But here we have two horns playing F sharp and two horns playing the D. Let's listen to the voicing and then we are going to talk about the balance problem within the brass section. Let's hear the first one. Now the second one. Once again, the first one and the second one in succession. Probably you noticed that in the first example, in the first voicing, this part sounds very weak. We hear very strong trumpets and then trombones and tuba, but the middle register is weaker than the other registers. But here we have a more homogeneous distribution. We hear all registers, all instruments, all chord tones at the same dynamic levels. The reason is the following. Because of the different dynamic power of the individual instruments, we might have to increase or decrease the number of the instruments playing. In our previous lesson, we saw that we divide the brass section into two groups. In one group, there is horn, and in the other group, there are trumpet, trombone, and tuba. Horn is a relatively soft instrument, and the other instruments are harder in sound. We call these instruments heavy brass. It is about the dynamic level, first of all. In mezzo forte or softer dynamic, horn and the other instruments are equal. But in a dynamic which is louder than mezzo forte, in order to balance one heavy brass instrument, we need two horns. For example, if the dynamic is forte and there is one trombone playing, and we want to balance this instrument with horns, then we need two horns. But in piano dynamic, for example, one trombone and one horn are equal. If we compare woodwinds with horns, horns are twice as powerful than the woodwind instruments. No matter which dynamic, in order to balance one horn, we always need two woodwind instruments. You see the same proportion here. In order to balance two horns, we need four woodwind instruments. Let's say the dynamic doesn't matter actually. If it is about woodwinds and horn, the dynamic is mezzo piano and there are three horns playing a chord, a pitch, or something that we want to balance with woodwind instruments, then we need six woodwind instruments. It could be, for example, two flutes, two oboes, and two clarinets playing at the same time. That gives us this pointing method. We said, in order to balance one horn, we need two woodwind instruments. That means horns are twice as powerful than woodwind instruments. If we give to a woodwind instrument 1 point, then we need to give to a horn 2 points because they are twice as powerful than woodwind instruments. If the dynamic is mezzo forte or softer, then the points of the heavy brass instruments and horns will be the same, 2 points, 2 points. But if the dynamic is louder than mezzo forte, we have to double the points of the heavy brass instruments. Let's take an example. Let's say the dynamic is fortissimo and there are five woodwind instruments, no matter which ones, and then three horns and two, let's say, trumpets playing. And we want to see if the resulting sound is balanced or not. Let's use our pointing table. It will be this one, B because the dynamic is louder than mezzo forte. 1 point for each woodwind instruments, that makes 5. 2 points for each horn, we have 3 horns, that makes 6 points. And 4 points for each heavy brass instrument, we have 2 trumpets, that makes 8 points. And we see 5 to 6 to 8. As we see, it is unbalanced. We will hear trumpets stronger than the horns and the horns stronger than the woodwinds. If we turn back to our voicings and apply the pointing method to our first chord, for example, we will see that we have, remember, 4 points for heavy brass because the dynamic was not quiet here, 4 points for each trumpet, 4 points for F sharp, and 4 points for D. And then we have only one horn playing F sharp and another horn playing D, that makes 2 plus 2. And here 4, 4, 4, and 4. That's why we hear this part quieter than the others. Let's listen to it. Once again. But in the second one, the voicing is balanced. We have 4, 4 here. This time we have 2 horns playing F sharp and 2 horns playing D. 2 times 2 makes 4, 4. And we have here also 4, 4 and a little unbalanced here, because we have 2 heavy brass instruments here, trombone, the 3rd trombone, and tuba, that makes 8 points. That means we will hear this pitch, the bass pitch, stronger than the other individual pitches, which is actually not a problem because this is the bass pitch. Hearing the bass pitch louder than the other pitches doesn't pose any problems. Let's listen to this one. Once again. In the 3rd one, we have a similar situation as the 1st one. We have a stronger upper part and a stronger lower part and a weaker middle register. Let's listen to it. The 4th one is an example of enclosed voicing between horns and trombones. We have the trombone pitches here, D and F sharp, which are enclosed by horns. It is not given if in the recording we hear 2 or 4 horns, which would be important actually in determining the balance. But those examples are mainly for the voicing, different kinds of voicing. For example, here enclosed voicing. Let's listen to this one. In the next one, we have an interlocked voicing between trumpets and horns. Let's listen to this one. And here we have an overlapping between the 1st trombone and the 2nd horn. And this D will be very weak. And we are going to hear a strong A and D in the trumpet. Let's hear it. The next one is an example of overlapping. We have an overlapping between those pitches and interlocking. The fourth horn is between the first and second trombones. Like the first one, we are going to hear those pitches very strong and also a strong lower part and a weaker, relatively weaker middle part. The same is true for the last one. This part will sound weaker. And this is an example of superimposed voicing. We have many possibilities for voicing a chord. Here we hear only heavy brass instruments, three trumpets and three trombones in their highest registers. Trumpets are their highest registers and trombones are also in their highest registers. The sound is very brilliant. Let's hear it. The next three examples are about superimposed voicing in fortissimo dynamic than in forte. In the first one, we will hear a weaker middle register and a very strong low register and high register. Let's hear it. This voicing is well balanced because we have four horns playing two pitches. That means two horns will play this pitch and two horns the other pitch. And we have a gap in this register which will make the sound more brilliant. Let's hear it. In the third one, the same voicing principle. The only thing is that every instrument went a little further down and the instruments are mainly in their low register. Trumpets in this register, horns also. But this is not the limit, of course. They are relatively lower. And the sound will be correspondingly darker. Let's hear it. The next example is in piano dynamic, but you will see it couldn't be a real piano in brass instruments. The voicing is mostly superimposed. We have only one overlapping here in D. The third trumpet overlaps with the first and third horn. And by the way, this is how we use the horns. First and third horns should play higher voices, and the second and fourth horns should play lower voices. Let's say we have a chord from high to low. This one should be played by the first horn, and the second one should play it by the third horn, and this one by the second horn, and the lowest one by the fourth horn. Let's hear this one. The next two examples are about first inversion chords, first inversion major triad. The first one is an example of superimposed voicing, trumpets, horns, and trombones. But the next one is an example of overlapping. Here we have one horn and one trombone playing this pitch, and also one horn and one trombone, and here two. And here, one horn and one trumpet. Those pitches will become stronger than the others because the volume level increases. We can check it. We have one trumpet, 4 points, another trumpet 4 points, and here one trumpet and one horn that makes it 6 points. And the same is true for the next ones, 6, 6, 6, etc. But at the same time, the color of these instruments will get blurred because of the doubling. And the result will be, we will hear these two pitches very clearly because they are unmixed, and the other pitches a little blurred. And because those pitches are higher than the other ones, we will perceive them a little louder anyway. That means we won't have any particular balance problems here. Let's hear the first one. And now the second one. And we have two further examples which are similar to this one with overlapping F sharp. We see an overlapping in F sharp, and then also between this A's and F sharps. Also D is alone, that means this part will sound weaker than the others, and we will have a mixed color, a blurred color in the middle register, in the alto tenor register. And in the last one we have the same situation. The only difference is the pitches are a little higher. Here we have an overlapping in A, and also here, and we have two pitches alone played by the horns in the middle. Let's hear the first one. Now the second one. As a general principle, it is not especially important to balance the middle register with the upper and the lower ones. The important part is that the low register and the high register are in balance, and that the middle register is present. The middle register could be a little stronger or a little weaker. That will affect, of course, the resulting sound, the resulting color, but that will not make a drastic difference in the instrumentation. Let's remember once again the proportion between instruments and our pointing method. In mezzo forte or softer dynamic, two woodwinds are equal to one horn, and one horn is equal to one heavy brass instrument. If the dynamic is louder than mezzo forte, then four woodwind instruments are equal to two horns, and two horns are equal to one heavy brass instrument, which also means that four woodwind instruments are equal to one heavy brass instrument. And our pointing method is according to this principle. If the dynamic is mezzo forte or softer, we give 1 point to each woodwind instrument, 2 points for each horn, and 2 points for each heavy brass instrument. However, if the dynamic is louder than mezzo forte, 1 point for each woodwind instrument, 2 points for each horn, and 4 points for each heavy brass instrument. These examples demonstrate how dynamic levels affect doubling and spacing. The first measure is in fortissimo dynamic, the second one in mezzo forte, and the last one is in piano dynamic. Let's take the trumpets. We see the trumpets in their highest register in fortissimo dynamic, then in their middle register in mezzo forte dynamic, and in their lowest register in the piano dynamic. those are natural dynamics for the corresponding register. Brass instruments cannot produce a real piano dynamic in the higher registers, and also cannot produce a real forte in the lower registers. If the dynamic decreases, the register of the instruments should also be lower. And in the trombones, we observe another fact, another principle. If the dynamic is loud, such as fortissimo, we see open structures, open structure voicings. If the dynamic decreases, we see gradually closer structures. We can also use open structure in quiet dynamic, but not the other way around. Especially in this register, in the low register, we have to avoid closed structures, closed voicings in loud dynamics. By the way, this is a transposed score. That means F horns, four F horns will sound a perfect fifth lower. And then we have two B flat trumpets, which will sound a major second lower. And trombones will sound as written. Let's listen to the first measure. And the second measure in mezzo forte dynamic. And the last measure in piano dynamic. As you know, in homophonic style, we have three musical functions. Melody, harmony, and bass. If we include brass instruments to our instrumentation, it will be highly important that these three functions are in balance. We can prefer to have a little imbalance between them. For example, we can prefer to hear the melody a little louder than the other functions, or the bass line, we can prefer to hear the bass line a little more, but more or less, they have to be in balance. There shouldn't be a proportion like 8 to 3 to 2, for example. In this case, bass would be too weak and the melody would be too penetrating. But the proportions like 5, 4, and 4 would be okay. This is an excerpt taken from the 4th symphony by Tchaikovsky. Let's listen to it, then we are going to talk about it. At the beginning, we have only the woodwinds and the brass instruments, and the brass section consists of four horns in F, two trumpets in F. Four horns in F would sound a perfect fifth lower, and trumpets in F would sound a perfect fourth higher. And then three trombones, alto, tenor, and bass trombone, and bass tuba. This is the standard tuba in the orchestra. And you see, the flutes are playing in unison, and the oboes and the clarinets are playing in octaves. And we have a print mistake here. They were supposed to be regular note heads. This is the condensed score of the beginning of the excerpt. If you look at the condensed score, then we will notice that we have three individual lines here. We have a melody lines doubled at the octave, and then we have a first harmony line beginning with E and then continuing with the upper line. This is the first harmonic line. And then we have a second harmonic line or a bass line. And this is the lower part of this line. And you see both lines are doubled at the octave. And in general, melodic line, first harmonic line, and second harmonic line, each of them are doubled at the octave. In such cases, we have two options in terms of orchestration. Either we use a particular instrumental color for each individual lines, or we can mix them. That means we use every instrumental color we have in each melodic line. For example, we can instrumentate the melodic line only with woodwinds. And the first harmonic line with horns, for example, and the second harmonic line with trombones. If you do this, we will separate the instrumental colors. Each melodic line will have its own instrumental color. Or we can give the melodic line for woodwinds, but also the first harmonic line and the second harmonic lines to the woodwinds. And also horns can play melody, first harmonic line and second harmonic line, and trombones or trumpets, because they are same color, let's say trumpets play melody and trombones play the first and second harmonic line. And this is an example for the mixed color. We call this one a homogeneous instrumentation. And the other one, heterogeneous instrumentation. If you compare the condensed score with the real score, this is our condensed score, and here we see the instrumentation of Tchaikovsky. If you compare them, we will notice that we have the melodic line in the flutes, oboes and clarinets, and also in the trumpets. Let's write it. The melodic line is played by two flutes, two oboes, two clarinets, and also two trumpets. And then we have our first harmonic line. It is played by the first horn and also one octave lower by the third horn. That means two horns play this one, and we have it also in the first bassoon and in the alto and bass trombone. That means two trombones. And finally, the bass line or the second harmonic line, we have it in the bassoon, one bassoon, and then the second and fourth horns. That means two horns. And the tenor trombone and the tuba. That means two heavy brass instruments. So, Those are instruments playing each individual line. Let's check if all three functions, all three melodic lines are in balance with each other. We can find it by using our pointing method. Because the dynamic is fortissimo, we are going to give 1 point for each woodwind instrument, 2 points to each horn, and 4 points to each heavy brass instrument. Let's begin with melody. 2 flutes, 2 oboes, 2 clarinets. We have 6 points here, and 2 trumpets. They will have 4 points each. That makes 8. And in total, we have 14 points. And we have 2 horns, 2 times 2, that makes 4. 1 bassoon, only 1 point. And 2 trombones, 2 times 4, makes 8. And here we have 13 points in total. And here 1 bassoon, 2 horns, 2 times 2, makes 4. 1 trombone and 1 tuba, 2 times 4, makes 8. If we add them together, we will see that makes also 13 points. And as you see, 14 to 13 to 13. That means this instrumentation is perfectly in balance. Only a very subtle difference between melody and the other functions, which is completely okay. As I said, this is an example of heterogeneous orchestration. Heterogeneous means each line has an individual color. In the melody, we have only 3 woodwind instruments and trumpets. And those colors are used only in the melody. They are not used in the first harmonic line and also not used in the second harmonic line. Likewise, in the horns, we hear only the first and second harmonic lines. We do not hear the melody, also not in the other instruments. This is an example of heterogeneous instrumentation. This is the final chord of the excerpt. Here we see the condensed score and here the instrumentation of Tchaikovsky. Let's take a look at the sections, at the individual sections. This is a B diminished seventh chord in first inversion. Let's check if the brass section is in balance in itself. We have 4 chord tones, B, D, F, and A flat. Let's take a look how many instruments are playing B natural. We have horns, 2 times 2 makes 4, and that's all actually in the section. And then D, we have D played by 2 heavy brass instruments, 2 times 4 makes 8. And then for F, we have 2 horns, that makes 4. And also alto trombone, that makes also 4, together 8. And A flat, we have 2 trumpets, that make 8. And 1 trombone, another 4, 12. We see a little unbalance here. B natural will sound weaker than the others, and A flat will sound stronger than the others. The reason could be that the composer wanted to make an emphasis on this A flat, but maybe he balanced this unbalance in the brass section with other instruments. Especially important are the wind instruments. Let's check them. B natural, we have 1 flute, 1 oboe, and 1 clarinet, that makes 3 extra points. And then for F, we have the same instruments, also 3 points, that makes 7. and that makes 11. And two Ds in the bassoons that make 10. As we see, the difference between the section decreased. We still have an imbalanced here, 7 to 10, but the difference here is lower, 12 to 11 to 10. But as you see, we are only talking about wind sections. We do not include the string section to our pointing method because the color of wind instruments are much more dominating than the string section. In the string section, we hear a homogeneous sound, but in the wind sections, we have many individual colors. So an unbalance in wind sections would have a much more drastic effect in the result. But of course, we have to consider the string section too. Remember the proportion B, D, F and A flat. That was 7, that was 10, 11 and 12. But we have two Bs, two Fs, 3 Fs, 2 Ds and only 1 A flat. And we see also here, also in the string section, A flat is less present. That means Tchaikovsky tries to balance this dominant A flat by using it less in the other sections. Let's listen to the excerpt once again. That's all for this lecture. Thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next lecture.